Hi guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and today we're going to talk about the Bocksten Man style cloak. Hey guys, welcome back. So after the soft kit overview video, a lot of people seem to be pretty enthusiastic about the idea of talking about more civilian-oriented medieval garments and things like that. Just so you know, my breadth of knowledge of civilian clothing and medieval fashion is a lot more restricted than my knowledge of arms and armor. So some of these videos will be a little bit more specific without the really broad historical surveys that I'm able to do with some of the armor stuff, but hopefully you find them interesting and informative anyway. Starting that, we're going to talk about the Bocksten style cloak that I was wearing, because that one got a lot of attention during that other video. Cloaks are kind of one of those essential pieces of medieval outerwear. They are fashionable. They are really good for things like keeping you warm in cold weather if you line them with furs and things like that. They're also really good for keeping you dry in wet weather. I've worn my cloak in the rain for decently long periods of time, and because it's a fairly heavy, dense weave of wool, I stay relatively dry on the inside. It's very excellent at repelling water. It takes a lot of water to actually soak through wool and get wet on the inside of the wool. So because of those properties, it's really great for things like having it in the rain. So it's not just kind of winter clothing like some people might assume. Now, we're going to be looking specifically at side closing cloaks, cloaks that are designed to close on the side that basically give you one arm free without having to sling it over the shoulder. Now, even going back as far as the late 12th century, we can see here in this image from the Winchester Bible that side fastening cloaks were an option that far back. This particular one is almost full length and lined with furs, as you can see by the pattern on the inside. They come in a lot of different varieties, so you're not just restricted to kind of one thing that you see in artwork. Here on the upper left character, you can see it's about waist length on him. Here's a full length example. This particular one has a more stylized closure, and if you look at the very bottom, you'll see what are called dags. That's basically a way to kind of make your clothing look a little bit more fancy, and those little shapes cut into the bottom hem of the cloak. On these guys, you can see that they're fur lined. If you look at the inside of their cloak as it hangs next to the side of the horse, you'll see these kind of telltale gray and white patterns. And what that is a representation, artistic representation of the pattern you get from taking gray squirrel bellies and basically stitching them together in these plates, and it forms that pattern. Even into the late 15th century, you can see an example here of a short side-opening cloak, the black cloak on the guy with the yellow hosen. Within the 14th century, which is kind of late 14th, early 15th century is my specific area of focus, you see a lot of variety on cloaks. This cloak, for example, has a standing collar integrated into the cloak, with a button closure from the collar all the way down the side of the shoulder. Lots of buttons, which is pretty fashionable for the 14th century. Here is another example with a side closure, a standing collar with what looks like some sort of dagged collar at the very top, and then dags all the way down the side of the opening and bottom of the hem. Here's another example of a dagged but slightly less fancy side opening cloak, but about waist length now. And then here, another short cloak, no dags, but still a collar present. So lots of varieties. Collar, no collar, dagging, no dagging, different varieties of length, basically from about waist length all the way down to ankle length. Once you start to get shorter than that, basically it becomes what most people would refer to as a mantle. Now, artwork is great, but it's hard for people who are interested in reconstructing these garments to really get insight into the construction and detail based solely on something like manuscript illuminations, which often don't take proportion into account very well, or you know, they don't show a lot of the construction details that, that you need to know when you're trying to build these things. So what's better than art is an actual extant survival. Unfortunately, when it comes to this side opening cloak, we have one in the form of the survival from the Bocksten Man finds. We could talk more about the Bocksten Man in the future, but kind of a brief overview. In the 1930s, a skeleton was found in Sweden in a bog. Bogs are really good at preserving organic material because they're an anaerobic environment, so no oxygen to promote decomposition. So a lot of things survived. The gentleman who was found was, he actually preserved his hair and a lot of his organic, his organ tissue, brain, liver, not complete, but in, parts of those things. But more importantly, for people who are interested specifically in medieval clothing, basically his entire outfit survived. He was wearing a hood, he had a cloak on, he had a bag, he even had knives with leather sheaths, an outer garment, a single leg hosen. So based on some of the things that he was wearing, it's likely that he was a late 14th century find because he matches the style of what was common at that point in time. Now, taking a look specifically at the cloak, this is how it was in its conserved state. And it's hard to really see a lot of the construction details, but it gives you an idea. You can tell that the cloak is basically a half circle, and it has an opening cut in the top for the neck. People kind of look at that, and that's where, if you're not really careful, it can kind of lead you astray and let you oversimplify the design in a lot of reconstructions. And what happens is people basically scribe out a half circle on fabric, cut a hole for the neck, put it on, and call it good. And it doesn't really sit right on the body. Especially during the late 14th century, people were really starting to tailor clothing to the human body, closely to the human body. They weren't ignoring the shape of the human body. What happens when you just do a half circle and a neck hole is it basically bunches up and kind of clumps up on the shoulders and neck. The real Bocksten cloak is actually made with the shape of the shoulders and the shape of the neck in mind, and it allows for the cloak to drape well over the shoulders. So here is a line drawing of the actual construction of the cloak, and we're going to kind of take an overview of this now. So you'll see that the main body of the cloak is indeed a half circle, but the body of the cloak is made of two main different kind of lengths of fabric. The reason that is the width of each of those lengths of fabric is basically the width of the loom that that fabric was made on. The bolt of fabric that was used just wasn't wide enough to get the full length of the cloak. So they took two pieces of fabric, each a loom width, and formed the full size of that cloak. And then you'll see that there are kind of other pieces, like off on the lower right here, and then there are three tiny little pieces on the bottom. So the loom widths obviously weren't enough to get all the way to the very bottom of the circle for the size that they had decided to make this cloak. So three smaller pieces of fabric were used to fill out that last little bit there. And then one of the big indicators of medieval tailoring is that a lot of fabric was, you know, especially if you couldn't afford a lot of fabric, you didn't want to waste any piece if you could help it. So, you know, this was probably a piece that was left over from another cutting that fit perfectly into there. So why not piece it together to form that circle, that half circle? But that's all well and good, and that kind of gives you that overall half circle shape, but it's not really directly related to the tailoring. So now I want to draw your attention to the neck hole itself. So you get into trouble when you just make a perfect symmetrical neck circle, because that's just not the way that a collar is actually made, even on modern clothing. The way that your head sits on your body, even when you have good posture and you're not like hunched forward like you're sitting at a computer all day like I tend to do, the collar on the back of your neck is a lot shallower than on the front of the neck where the cut is much deeper. The cut is deeper to accommodate the way that your neck sits on your torso. Your if the collar were cut as deeply in the back as it was in the front, you'd have kind of a big gap behind your neck instead of it riding up nicely on the neckline and following the length of the shoulders. So when we look at the Bocksten tunic, you'll see that on the left side as we're viewing it, which when, now keep in mind this cloak is designed to close over the right shoulder. So the left part of the neck hole as we're viewing it is what will sit on the front of the throat. And then on the right, that's what will go over the back. You'll see that the front is actually cut deeper than the hole in the back. And that mimics what's occurring on modern shirts. The front of the collar is cut deeper than the back so that you don't have that gap in the back, or the alternative is so that it's not trying to choke you or ride too high up in the front. The next part I want to draw your attention to are the little diagonal cuts at the top of the neck opening. So those little diagonal cuts are what will form the actual closure of the cloak. That's what's going to sit over the right shoulder. Now, when you look at a modern shirt, you have a seam usually that goes down the top of the shoulder line here. That is basically fulfilling that same function. If the top edge of the cloak were just straight until it got to the neck opening, what would happen is instead of having this nice shoulder shape, it would just kind of bunch up and you'd have excess fabric at the top of the shoulder. So what this does is when it's closed, it basically forms that shoulder seam and gives you that shoulder slope. Now, obviously you have two shoulders. How would you create a shoulder seam on the other side when you just have continuous fabric there? Well, that's what that little inverted triangle is doing there. In tailoring lingo, basically what that would be called is a dart. So you take a triangular cut of fabric, and you take that now open triangle with those two raw edges, and you close that and sew them together, and that will form the slope on the other side. So that when we view the cloak as it would be worn, you get this cone, and then as it reaches the shoulders, it forms to the slope of the shoulders before reaching the collar and the opening for the neck hole. And that's how it sits properly on the human body. Now, here is my reconstruction, and you'll see here's the neck hole. So this is the part that's going to sit against the front of my throat. You can see that it cuts a lot deeper than the part that sits against the back of my neck. So that's that asymmetrical neck hole. This is the seam that's formed by the dart. So you can see it puckers up a little here because this is what's going to sit over my shoulder, but when worn, it looks proper. So basically when I started, the seam was open like this. I cut out the fabric in between, closed that, and sewed it closed to form that seam. On the top, this is the neck closure. So buttonholes on this side, buttons on the other side, but you'll see you get those diagonal cutouts here, and that's what forms this shoulder seam on the other side when it's closed. And now I'll put it on so that you can see that in action. All right, so on my reconstruction, the actual body is a half circle, just like the Bocksten. And like we saw a lot of the variety in the artwork, I chose to make mine about mid-length. It's dagged along the edges, which are the basically squared off pieces at the bottom. And then it is lined in a contrasting color of wool. I elected to go with self-fabric buttons. What I mean by self-fabric buttons is the buttons are made from the same fabric as the rest of the garment. And then I'll show you why the tailoring is important when it's being worn. So I'll put it on. All right, so now you can see that when it's sitting on the human form, what was that dart that I showed you is now sitting on the left shoulder, and that's what gives you that proper shoulder slope on this side. And then on the right side, you actually have the closure, which forms the shoulder slope on the right side. The collar is deeper in the front to accommodate the way that the neck sits. And then in the back, the collar rises a little bit higher to accommodate the way that the neck sits in the back. You can see the length here probably comes down just to about my knee. If it's cold, you can get both your arms under there if it's raining. And then you always have one free arm if you need it. And then if you do require both arms, you can flip the remainder of the cloak over the left shoulder and it will free up both arms to do whatever you need, whatever task you need to do. And then, and it does not have a tendency to slide back down just because of the nature of the wool itself. It really sticks to itself well. So when it's slung over the shoulder, you know, you can kind of lean forward and move about and do different tasks, and it doesn't constantly just like slide down. I really have to kind of pull it down to get it to come back down, which is a nice feature. All right, guys, so that's everything. Hope you found the video informative. If you have any questions or comments, please leave those down below and I'll get to those as soon as I can. Let me know what other things you guys would like to see for future videos, and I will try to accommodate those to the best of my ability. And thank you very much to my supporters on Patreon who have decided to help support the channel. Feel free to follow me on Facebook, check out the website, any of those other things that you guys might be interested in. Thank you. Bye.